Hello, everybody, and welcome to our eighth episode of Symphony Tacoma's Facebook Live. I'm really glad to have a very special guest with us tonight. We were due to perform with Symphony Tacoma tonight and playing a fantastic program of the Roaring Twenties with Gershwin and Ravel, and also the wonderful Boulanger sisters. And sadly, not able to get together. We all know why. But here we are, in some ways together. I bring you the wonderful, world-renowned and fantastic friend of mine, Charlie Albright. Hi, Charlie, you there? Excellent.
Hey, Sarah. I figured we were doing the Roaring Twenties, and this is as close to that as I've got. So I'll put this on for about 20 seconds and take it off.
So I have a technical issue, and that is that I cannot actually hear you right now. So I'm going to have to let you talk for the moment, and I'm going to switch my platform.
Okay, sounds so good.
Tell everybody how you're doing.
All right, so it's good to be here. My hair is a mess. I never wear hats, but it's really good to be here and to spend the evening with all of you. I'm at home here, and it's a beautiful day. And tonight, as Sarah was saying, we were scheduled to perform two pieces together, and it was going to be the Nadia Boulanger Fantasy for Piano and Orchestra, which is a piece that I had never played before. Beautiful piece, and that's the one there's going to be a premiere of at the end at 8:15 on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/pianomanca, Charlie Albright, not California. And oh, Sarah is back. Are you there, Sarah?
I'm here.
Okay, I'm just explaining that I was about to play, we were scheduled to play the Nadia Boulanger and then the Rhapsody in Blue. That was going to be the other piece that was going to be on tonight's docket.
What? You know, this is going to be our fourth or fifth performance together, so I'm really too sad about it. And this is going to be quite an epic program. But we got something really special for everybody tonight, even though they're not going to hear you live in person. You've created something very special for everybody. Can you tell us about that?
Sure. So I have been, since, you know, we're all staying at home and stuff, I've been doing a lot of recording and making videos for YouTube and stuff on my YouTube channel, plug, youtube.com/pianomanca. But I learned the Nadia Boulanger for this concert that we were gonna give. And it's one of those pieces that is almost never played. I think there's maybe one recording of it with an orchestra that I've out there at period. And so I figured, well, it'd be a shame to learn the piece and not get to play it. So when I realized that, you know, the concert was likely not going to happen, I said, well, I learned it. I might as well record at least the piano part of it because it's in my fingers and I practice it. So why not? So that's what that is.
Mm-hmm. And it's a gorgeous piece of music. I think the reason that I came across this was because I'd heard that Nadia was renowned as a teacher, of course, a great composition teacher, but she was also a composer. And I previously performed one of her sisters, her younger sister's pieces, Lili Boulanger. And that's a very short piece. And Lili's music is very effervescent, it's bubbly, and quite contrary to the tragedy that happened to her, because she died, I think, very, very young, before her 20s. And Nadia, sadly, stops practicing composing after this, and really just became very renowned as a teacher. But then I was looking, we must hear something by her. So I looked for this piece and found it online, thankfully. But then we could find the music nowhere. And it was quite an epic job to actually track down the parts. It took us, our librarian, our wonderful librarian, Peggy, a long time to find it. Eventually, we had to call Paris, the Radio France, actually. Even I called and left a message in French. And eventually, after several emails, we managed to get in touch with them and get the music for it. So, you know, I thank you so much for learning something rare and special like this. So let's put ourselves in the 20s. And here is a little presentation just to give you a bit of a sample of how that concert would feel. So Susan's going to bring up this special thing. You can listen to a bit of the Boulanger. This is both Charlie playing Gershwin and then the Boulanger, just a little sample of it. Just to put you in the picture, have a listen to this. Putting us in the picture of the roaring 20s, Charlie, you have played the Gershwin Rhapsody in Blue how many times now?
Oh man, I don't think I could count, a lot. It's one of my favorite pieces to play. I've played it all over the place. It's a lot of fun.
And it sounds very much like an improvisation in a way, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Can you that process when you play it? Are you tempted to start improvising? Because I know you're a fantastic improviser.
Sure. Well, in the Rhapsody in Blue, it sounds like it's an improvised piece, but almost every single note, at least most of the notes that I play, are actually written out. So he really wrote out a lot of what you hear in it. I like to take liberties, not just in that, but in a lot of the pieces that I play. Some might agree, some might not, but I do like to take especially liberties with that piece because it's so jazzy and it's so free that you know, I'll change up some of the rhythms or add some notes or chords here and there, and I figure why not.
Yeah. We want to let everybody know out there that we would love to take your questions for Charlie. This is a wonderful moment to think about the things that you'd like to ask this dazzling world-class pianist who's played with us well many times with me. We also have some videos of Charlie and I playing at the first time we worked together, was it 2017? And I think we're going to put some links in the chat so that if you would like to watch that later, you're very welcome. But tonight, the Boulanger you have recorded for us, and can you tell us how it is for you to play these two very different pieces? Because Boulanger, Nadia's music, is very rich and deep and sad. How do you switch gears?
That's a really good question. You're asking the hard one, Sarah. I think, you know, when you're playing a piece of music, you know, you can value different things. For me, I would rather miss half the notes and say something with the music then hit everything perfectly, but you know, not really express or say something or communicate through the music. And you know, I like to think that, you know, if I can move one person, if one person is touched and it comes up to me after a concert and has maybe tears or something, I know that regardless of what the critics say or what the review says or anything, you know, I did my job that night. I affected someone in some personal way, and hopefully a good way. So when you're switching pieces, you know, I think for me, putting your kind of feeling the emotion that you're trying to bring out of the piece, what you're trying to draw out of what the composer wrote is really important. And trying to put yourself in that emotional and mental state of the music, I think is very helpful.
Yes, and that is in a way also what Nadia Boulanger was very much about as a teacher. She was very much interested in breaking down whatever the normalcy was and really stretching a composer to find something really special and unique in their compositions. For example, she refused to teach pianola, though he very much wanted to study with her. She said, you must find your own unique language. And I think that's the most extraordinary thing. When you improvise as well, you create a new language from notes and things like that. But also, when you just perform, you're always navigating the emotional content. And that's one of the reasons I like playing with you, Charlie, is because you've just got music coming out of, you know, every bone in your body and into the piano. And you also get the notes as well. That's pretty good.
Some of them, not all of them. Definitely not all.
We have a question from Paul Wright. Hi, Paul. Charlie, do you have a favorite composer?
Hi, Paul. I know Paul. I've met Paul after some concerts all over the country. Do I have a favorite composer? Not one. I like a lot of kind of like classical to romantic music. So I tend to like late Beethoven and Chopin, that kind of realm of stuff. I'm a romanticist in terms of music, I guess. I just love the schmaltzy stuff. The Nadia Boulanger is kind of like that in a way, even though it was composed not in the romantic period. When I first heard it, with that the one recording of a piano and orchestra that exists, I thought it almost belonged on Fantasia. Remember that Disney movie with the beautiful cartoon and animation matched to the music? It's just such a gorgeous piece. Mm-hmm. But yeah,
it is. The other thing I wanted to let people know is that tonight we are actually celebrating with a fundraiser. So if anybody's been watching along these episodes, we would love you to be aware that we had set a goal 2020 to reach by the end of this evening. And so I'm going to ask, if you are watching this right now, if you could go to the share button of this actual post and share it with your friends, maybe we can get some more followers to listen to this premiere. And this premiere is really Charlie's debut of the Boulanger. At the end of the program, we're going to be giving you a YouTube premiere of the Boulanger Concerto on Charlie's channel. So that'll be once we finish our chat with Charlie. But for now, we're going to give you a few teasers, a few snippets of that, a wonderful concerto, so you can hear a little bit of the Nadia Boulanger right now.
Thank you.
Exciting, exciting stuff, and I can't wait to perform it in Symphonicum too. What was it like learning this piece? How does it compare closely to other concertos that you played? Or is it completely different and unique? Any similarities?
It was a lot of fun learning it. It was different. Learning a piece that you don't know at all is very different than learning one that you've heard 50 million times, you know, other people play it. For me, I'm always a very slow learner of notes. For me, like, I can memorize things more quickly, but in comparison to my ability to actually like read the notes, I can't sit down and just, so for me, you know, when it's a piece, especially a contemporary one where a lot of the notes aren't necessarily what you might expect, you know, they're kind of weird ones. It takes a little bit of time, but it's a one movement piece. So the entire thing is not quite 20 minutes, I suppose, something like that. Depends if you play with the orchestra or not, but it's all one movement. So there's really no breaks, but there's very clear sections of the piece. You know, that you, in that section, we heard that excerpt, we heard a very slow lyrical portion, and the end has that little fancy, you know, just random kind of note type sounding things. And it has like these very clearly demarcated sections. With their own personality. So it's a lot of fun, but it's different learning something that you really are completely unfamiliar with.
So now, I asked that in particular because Nadia was not confident about herself as a composer. She tried many, many times to win the Prix de Rome. I find her music really interesting and beautiful and quite unique. It's much more flexible. It's not in a rigid a structure, very much going places. Lili, her sister, actually did win the Prix de Rome, the composition prize, but Nadia, I think, felt that her sister was much more talented than her and gave up. As I think it's such a tragedy that she gave up. So we try to bring her music back to life, and you're doing that for us tonight. Thank you so much. Everybody, I hope you're enjoying. Evening. Please keep sharing our program with your friends so that we can raise some money for Symphony Tacoma and that other people out there can get ready for this YouTube premiere tonight. Charlie, should we take some questions from people? Can you see any of them? Somebody said, what is the most difficult piece you've ever performed? From Sharon. Hi, Sharon.
Hi, Sharon. Good question. It's a hard one because there's different kinds of difficult, I think. There's, you know, there's difficult in terms of how many notes and how fast something is. That's also closely related to maybe how difficult it is to memorize something, because some pieces have such similar things that if you mess up one little thing, you could end up playing, looping back to the very beginning of a piece. And that's not so bad if you're playing by yourself, but with an orchestra, with you have 100 other people with you, if you're the only one going back, it, you know, could cause a problem. And then there's also like the difficulty of the emotional side, right? Like getting the maturity, getting the depth of a piece or what's written underneath and in between the notes. And sometimes those are technically very simple. So I don't know if there's one, but you know, they've ranged from one of the more emotionally difficult ones I've done are some of the late Schubert sonatas. They're very technically, they're not too bad, but emotionally they're very difficult. In terms of difficult technically, you know, there's a ton of them. But thanks for the question. I guess Sarah's, oh yeah, here she is.
We have also from me, how do you approach learning a new composition? If you have very little time to learn a new piece, what is your focus? Thank you, Julie.
That's a great question too. Even if you try not to be in that position, sometimes it happens that there's a position, you get put in a position where it's like, oh, there's a concert and you don't know the piece and you have to learn it very quickly. As I said earlier, I'm bad at learning notes. So that's extra difficult for me, I think. So for me, start with the notes. You know, you got to be able to play the notes to be able to put emotion behind it at least. And so I try to learn the notes, you know, counting ledger lines, writing stuff in. But, you know, ideally, you know, I'd like to give myself minimum a year to work on a big piece of music, minimum, and preferably 2 or more years, because, you know, learning the notes is just part of it, but then you really want to kind of put your own stamp on it and put your own interpretation in it. And that really takes time and kind of just living with the music, playing it regularly and practicing it regularly. And then you learn what works and what doesn't, and it kind of grows with you. Even pieces that I have played in the past that I played for, you know, maybe over a decade, it changes every time I play. And if I put it away and then bring it back a year or two later, the way I interpret it is different then than it was, you know, prior.
Thank you. That's really interesting. A year to 2 years. I mean, that is the hard work, hard sweating work of just one piece. So imagine if you have to learn 10 or 20 concertos, and I know you've mastered many, many concertos. It's a lot of practice, a lot of practice. Paula Reese Lovelace, thank you. Actually, it was right there, the comment, and then it flipped away. Can you see Paula's? Oh, do you have a mentor for musical interpretation? And do you have a revered pianist?
Oh my goodness. So, you know, my mentors include my teachers, right? So growing up in Centralia, Washington, my teacher for a very long time, my main teacher while I was living here was Nancy Adsit. And she lives out in Michigan now. And then when I was out in college, I was with Park Young-byun, and then I did postgrad work with Veda Kaplinsky. And so they're all, you know, I consider all of them my mentors in terms of, you know, interpretation stuff, I suppose. I don't suppose, they definitely are. In terms of like revered pianists, I really like Marie Pariah, Emmanuel Axe. I think they're wonderful artists. Russell Sherman, and I have too many to name. They're all wonderful, and I respect them all.
One of my favorites, and I'm interested to know if you have this as well, is Rubinstein.
Yes, Rubinstein is another one of the greats. So it's lots of good ones out there.
We have shared with everybody some links to some videos that I found about Nadia Boulanger and her speaking about the composers that she knows You know, she was very, very good friends with Stravinsky, and was asked to teach one of Stravinsky's children, and so formed a very, very lifelong relationship with him. Also, Bernstein, she was the first conductor, woman conductor of the Boston Symphony Orchestra and the New York Philharmonic. And I keep coming back to her because I feel that she has such an epic legacy and has been really renowned to be one of the most important teachers of composition in the 20th century, even teaching Copland, for example. And there was an article quite recently in the New York Times about from Ned Roram, who's a wonderful composer, about her too. And this is why I think I wanted, in particular, this piece to be played. And I'm so thrilled that you're going to do a Facebook premiere, but it's not the same without the orchestra.
Oh, absolutely.
It's still fantastic, I have to say. Let's see if there's any more questions for you. We're getting through our program, and I just want to remind everybody that we have a wonderful Facebook fund. We're hoping to reach the goal of 2020 by the end of this evening. So if you're watching this even after the fact, you can still donate to Symphony Tacoma. And we've been doing a lot of planning on virtual programming, such as this Facebook Live, but on some other really cool ideas. But before we go there, tell us about your process of improvisation. Do you want to see if we can take a few notes? If our audience can send in a favorite note they have each, like the E or the B, you could explain your process of improvisation. Because this is something you're fantastic at in so many different styles. Tell us how that works for you.
Sure. So, you know, for me, improvisation is I learned how to play piano before I learned how to read music. So I started when I was like 3 and a half or so, and until I was about 7 or 8 and started taking from Mrs. Adson, I only played by ear. So I played everything from the Backstreet Boys, which were popular back then, to, you know, to Great Balls of Fire. I still play Great Balls of Fire, but that's another story. I think it's kind of started then. I would oftentimes, you know, like listen to things and, you know, play it back, or someone would play something for me and I'd play it back and change it up. And so, you know, kind of making things up was always a part of, you know, how I started and loved piano. So a few seasons ago, I started incorporating that again into my concert programming. And so now I, you know, whenever I can, I'll improvise a cadenza in a concerto, or have, you know, anywhere from a 10 to a 30 minute long to an entire concert that's entirely improvised. And so if I ask for notes from an audience, they'll give me random notes, and I'll usually ask for 3 or 4 because that's usually just an easy number. And usually the fourth one never fits because, you know, people try to give me a screwball type, you know, twister at the end that doesn't fit with the other three notes. But I oftentimes liken improvisation, for me at least, to playing with Legos. So, you know, if you think of if you have a big box of Legos with different colors and different shapes, you know, you have the 2x3s and you have the thin ones and the thick ones, and they're all different colors. You can take Legos and build anything you want, right? You can say, I want to build a house and build a house with the Legos, and or I could build a rocket or a car. You don't necessarily take the Legos out, cut them to your own sizes. You use what you have and you put them together to make into a whole that makes sense. So for me, it's kind of like that when I improvise. So I'll take you know, the feeling or the type of music and the feel that I want in my head, and think, okay, that's what I want to kind of make. I want to have a beginning and a middle and an end, and I want that, and I have X minutes to do it. And then people will give me notes, and I'll say, okay, how can I fit that into what I'm trying to create to make it, you know, to make it work? And then basically as you go, you're picking up a red Lego and a green one and a long yellow one. You're putting them together to build that in your mind. So you aren't necessarily reinventing the wheel as you go. You're just quickly taking things that you already have in your bucket and putting them together to build what you want.
Did you play Lego when you were younger?
Oh, I love Legos.
Do you still play with Lego?
No. So the my next door neighbors have children who have Legos. So sometimes I'll play it with them.
when we're building or something. My kids still love Lego. We have a question from Alison Unterreiner. Thank you for watching tonight, Alison. What do you, Charlie, do to create balance in your life given the intensity of your musical career?
Well, that's a good question. What do I do to balance? Well, I mean, I think the entire world right now is going through a very, you know, difficult, unprecedented time. So it's very different now. You know, I'm not traveling as much. I'm not traveling at all. Everyone's at home, so it's a very different kind of an experience. When I am, you know, touring and stuff, you know, it's a lot of time in hotels and stuff. So you want to try to keep as healthy as you can, and you know, that's both physically and mentally. You know, you want to have downtime, relaxation time. So I'm a fan of Korean dramas. I'm half Korean, so I grew up with Korean dramas, binge watching Family Guy, you know, all that good stuff. When I'm at home, doing stuff in the yard, like today, I striped my lawn, so I mowed it, and you can't really see it. You see it when the sun is out. So I love doing yard work because I'm just one of those guys who likes yard work. But that kind of thing is, you know, just relaxing, spending time with my wife, Stella, watching movies with her, and so, yeah, you know, just hanging out.
Thank you. I'm just texting. I see there's a question, and I love your garden, by the way, and the surface
is so
busy. And we have a question from somebody wanting to know where the Symphony Tacoma donations page is. And so I thought I'd answer that in case there are other people out there. You go to our, you might want to open a new tab or go to Symphony Tacoma's Facebook page, and there is a fundraiser section of Facebook, and you click on that, and there should be a fundraiser set up for tonight's program with a goal of 2020. And this is our eighth program of these. We hope to be able to continue in the future. So hopefully that will help, and maybe Karina or some backstage can answer that as well. Oh, there's a link. Fantastic. So you should be able to find a link in the comments. So do you play any other instruments? That's from Jim Short.
Oh, Jim, I do not play any other instruments. There's 88 keys on the piano, and I still can't play them all quite right yet. So I'm focusing on that for now. I do a lot of composing for fun, not just for piano, but I like calling it Hans Zimmer music. So I use, you know, computer with sample libraries. So I'll create, you know, very epic sounding, you know, kind of the Dark Knight, you know, Gladiator type sounding music. But luckily I can do all of that on a computer using a keyboard. So that's as close as I get.
So I just wanted to thank you for being with us tonight. You have prepared this wonderful video that we are going to watch as a YouTube premiere. And we're going to put that link up in the comments for everybody to go. And it's starting at 8:15, and it's already scheduled. It's a YouTube premiere.
Look at that, right there.
Live, and this was, there you go, right. And I'm excited. It's the complete piano part. Tell us about what people are gonna hear.
So yes, so I so the Nadia Boulanger was one of the two pieces we were scheduled to play tonight. I'll move over here. And so I basically, I learned the piece for this concert, but unfortunately we can't give it. So I figured, well, I'll at least play the piano part, and because, you know, who knows, next time I'll be able to play it, hopefully very soon. So I recorded it, and it'll be on, it was down there, so youtube.com/pianomanca. So that's where I upload a lot of my videos. So subscribe there, it's free, and you can see me play that and other things. And be sure to subscribe to, you know, facebook.com/symphonytacoma, and also mine as well. I'll plug mine as well. It's facebook.com/charliealbrightpianist.
And I have
one too. Yours is it Sarah.Ioannides?
Yes, I think so.
I think it's a dot in yours, yeah.
So
but yeah, if you
say goodbye, we have to end now so that people can go and watch that in time. And what we're going to end with is Charlie playing Gershwin, Rhapsody in Blue, just the piano part, recorded specially for you guys tonight. So Thank you so much, Charlie. I'm looking forward to playing with you many more times in the future. And watching, enjoy tonight. Thank you for your donation. Thank you for supporting us through this terrible, terrible time in life for so many millions of people. We are lucky that we have music in our hearts and we can just keep the music alive and keep uplifting people with incredible talents like Charlie Albright. Thank you so much, Charlie. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Stay well.
Stay safe and healthy.